In today's video, you're gonna learn how to model, texture, and light a beautiful jellyfish scene inside a Cinema 4D. Let's go. Hey, it's Nick here again from grayscalegorilla.com, bringing you the tools, training, and tutorials to help make you a better motion designer. Now, today we have a segment from our Ask GSG series, which is where you can bring your Cinema 4D questions directly to us live, and we try to answer them live on our Twitch channel. So if you'd like to get more information about that, you could click below, get the times and the episodes. And also, if you've missed past seasons of Ask GSG, we actually have those available on our training page. Hundreds of hours of Ask GSG questions and answers that you can watch instantly on any device. So check that out down below, and I'll also link that up on YouTube right here. In today's episode, we had Patrick Goski on the show, and he's an incredible sculptor and modeler, and he has just such great taste with his renders. So it was really great to see a really fun scene that we could try to recreate. It's this beautiful jellyfish scene that they had a question about, and so in this episode, you're gonna see us start from scratch, mostly Patrick, start from scratch, model this thing, texture it, and then light it at the end. It's a really fun episode. It's one of my favorites, so I hope you enjoy it. So without further ado, let's head on in and let's make some jellyfish. Hey everybody, and welcome to another Ask GSG. I'm here with Patrick Goski. Dang yeah. It, I mess it up every time. Oh. Patrick Goski. I've been calling you Goski. Anyway, we're here with Patrick Pagoski.
Pagoski.
From the Twitter. And he's here to help try to answer some questions. So we got a question here. Can't forget the screen. We got a question here from Brett Morris about how we would this jellyfish. And I figure since Patrick's here and he's so great at all the sculpting and modeling and all this stuff, it'd be nice to see how you would approach making this kind of model. And then maybe at the end, if we have some time, we can duplicate it around and light it up and talk about blurry reflections and maybe reflectance a little bit and try to get a basic version of this scene going.
Cool.
What do you think?
I think that sounds excellent.
I wanted to give a shout out to James Gardner, let's get the full name here. It got James Gardner Pickett for this awesome stuff. They actually linked to that shoe. Beautiful work here. I really appreciate it. And the warp line. So people have been looking at his stuff, and it's always nice to look at who made this stuff. So thank you, James. And let's go head on in to Cinema 4D, and we'll save this, is what we'll do. That's our last one. And we'll start from scratch and take it away, Patrick. How would you approach making a jellyfish?
All right. So I guess the first thing I'll do is take a look at the jellyfish image again. There we go. So, you know, we got some major parts here. We got the bulb on the top of the jellyfish, this piece coming off down here, and then the streamers. So thinking about things that I already know in Cinema, we could do a simple like loft or polygon modeling or anything here to get this shape. Not a loft. What's that other one?
Lathe?
A lathe. Exactly. We could do that.
I knew something. That's like a first.
I didn't know something.
That's a first too.
And then rather than actually like model in all the detail here, I think just relying on like a displacer and some simple gradients would be pretty wicked. This chunk here is probably going to be like a spline wrap and some deformed geometry. Again, we could use displacer for that sort of thing. And then maybe the hair system just to get these strands coming off the end.
Cool.
How's that sound?
I can't wait.
Yeah. All right.
What's really nice is it looks like at the end it's almost all the same texture on
yeah,
the whole thing.
I think so. And we get to do blurry reflections, so you can't go wrong. Okay, let's start with the front view then. And my favorite spline, which is sometimes the B spline. So I'm just going to go in. We'll create a very basic shape here. And since I'm a stickler, yeah, it kind of folds under more. It's really wide. We're good. Okay. Where is it?
There. Sorry.
Oh, don't be sorry.
I am.
Can't be. That's too Canadian of you.
No, I'm from Michigan. We're practically Canadian.
Yeah.
We're apologetic.
It's close. Okay, so we got that. Let's center out this centerpiece. The center point, and not under there, lathe, and we can do our spline. And so let's call this the jelly profile. And this is the jelly fish body thing.
Yeah, that's about right.
Okay. I like that. How finished should I get these? Or let's block everything in first. I mean, that's practically what we need. We can go maybe into simulate. We want to add a little bit of thickness. So we'll do the cloth surface on there. Do you like keeping things like at a specific level for cinema, or can we go for whatever?
As far as scale?
Like, do we want stuff that's only broadcast? Do we want stuff that's studio?
Oh, no. Studio's fine. Okay. We just kind of assume we have the tools. You use whatever tools you want.
Perfect. Okay, so yeah, we got a little bit of thickness on there, and we'll return back to that when we get a chance. Now we want this piece coming out the bottom here. There's a few ways that we could approach this too. I think what I'll do is actually just go into polygon mode and use Shift-C the polygon pen. And I tried this out once before, but I think this time it's a lot more appropriate. So we'll make this a bit bigger, and we can just draw something out like that. Actually, you know what? Let's not make this curved at first. Let's do a Command-Z. We'll do a plane, so that we can go with something really boring. And we'll go with the Z-axis here, and drag this out so that we got something longer, like so. How long do we want this tail? Maybe we just want it that long. And we want to have one segment, and check out our wireframe. And let's go height segments. We want to do a whole bunch. And then width segments, we'll do a couple there. So that's not too bad. Then from this point, let's go ahead and add a displacer. And I think, I think what we can do is, let's do a fall off on this guy and make it a box. And bring this down here. And we'll bring the y-axis way up. Maybe hold down shift so that goes faster. And then in our shading, I'm just going to do like a noise. And then let's bump up our segments again, so we can start seeing some distortion on this. And if we increase the height there, this is looking kind of nice. Invert that. Oh, this is getting closer. What do we need to do? Make it thinner? Is that what we should do? Yeah, I like that. And again, if we need more detail, we can add that in here. I'm going to go with some really crazy numbers for the polygons. Displacer, shading, noise. Maybe what I want to do is stretch the noise out along the x-axis a bit. So we got x, y, z. So we can try this here. Really pull that out so that we start getting something like that. It is kind of fun building these out, because you see like different ways that you could possibly approach it every single step. Because I'm like, yeah, this is cool, but maybe we could do it this way. Okay. I like the look of that. Now, what I want to do is get it to taper down a bit towards the end. So still using the plane, we're going to add in a taper and put that after the displacer. Or, actually, let's put that before the displacer. After the displacer.
You just want to either distort the taper the already distorted stuff, or distort the already tapered stuff.
Exactly. Right? And I'm indecisive, so it could go either way. But I think I want to taper the distorted stuff. So we'll kind of taper that off so we get a nice shape there. And then hide these from view. We kind of get, you know, it's not horrible, right?
It's interesting.
Yeah, that could work. Okay, so I have this main shape here, and I want to get that to follow some splines. So maybe there's... Actually, it might be better to do this with hair, but this will give you a quick idea of how we can actually get the basic effect here. And then maybe we can try it out with hair. So we would go in with the spline. We would want to use a spline wrap, and we're going to do the spline wrap after the taper, and we want to reference our spline here. And things should look pretty messed up. Yeah, they do. So what we need to do is make sure to set our spline wrap along the same direction as the geometry. So this should be plus y. And we got that one. Oh, look, our tiny end is at the bottom, so let's go minus y. Fat end at the top, tiny end at the bottom. Perfect. We can go into our rotation, and let's do this with our rotation. Check this out.
Cool. I was wondering about the rotation.
So now we got some wicked twisting in there. And if we want this to be a little bit crazier, what do I want to go here? Let's try changing the rotation strength. That's a lot of fun. Okay, so we got that. Let's group this in its own group, and we can also put this inside of its own cloth NURBS. So simulate cloth, cloth surface, and add some thickness. Boom. And then put that in a hyper NURBS. Oh my, did I just say that?
It's not a hyper NURBS anymore.
Hush, it is nothing but hyper NURBS. let's see, let's go there. What do I want? Maybe I want less geometry along the width.
So the hyperNURB tapers more?
Yeah. So it's going to reduce some of the frilliness that we had there. But we could always go in and add like a texture afterwards as well on top of this to give it even like more detail. So yeah, I'm digging where this is at so far. Maybe we can go back to our displacer. The nice thing is we can like really play around with these now to
see what
we got going on.
Some of those, even just that profile looks better. It's like really random.
Yeah.
I like that big displacement.
Yeah, the big displacement I think is definitely the way to go. It makes me want to do even more subdivisions on the height, though, so we can get some like
really wrinkly, really nasty stuff
looking stuff there. Yeah,
slimy. This stuff's been underwater its whole life,
definitely.
You know,
I mean,
it's gonna look pretty gross.
Generally when they're not underwater they're kind of dead, aren't they?
I would think so.
Yeah, maybe. Oh, look at that, we can do this. So yeah, like the cool thing is here is like with this setup we're dealing with something that's pretty procedural too. Yeah, we got all that. Let's, maybe if, we're just doing a still, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I don't have to worry about animating this?
Yeah.
Oh, no.
Oh, the spline.
Let's do both of these. We'll do, Alt-G. We'll do the tentacle.
Tentacle.
I don't think that's right. It's tentacle. Something like that.
Tentacly.
And then we'll do the instance of this guy. Maybe we'll try rotating again. That works a lot better.
There you go.
And we'll make another copy like so, and another copy like so. Maybe this one. Let's go to our scale. I love doing stills when you just don't have to worry about animating stuff. It's kind of beautiful
you
sometimes.
You cheat a little bit more, right?
Yeah. Let's see. Is this in a good location? Okay, cool. Then we want to do... What parts are we missing? There's like that...
We got the hairs?
Weird hairs, yes. Maybe for the hairs, we'll cheat a little bit too. We'll just do a ring like that. Let's hide all of our tentacles. And let's hide that and that. And just change this guy here so that it matches the endpoint on this. Just like so, and we can bring that down a little bit.
Hmm.
And then if we bring that back, just like so. It's coming from the inside. Cool. We can grow some hair off of this. So dynamics, hair objects, add hair. Our hair is going the wrong direction, whatever. Let's make it really long. So the cool thing is actually with the hair object, I could use this to create the other tentacles as well.
And then clone along those or something like that.
Yeah. Yeah, so in our hair, we can go to generate, and there's an option here to instance.
Mm.
And if I choose that, I'd actually be able to link in this tentacle, and it might cause craziness to happen.
You might.
Maybe
want.
It needs to be polygons
save.
First. Maybe, dude, I keep telling you, my save function is when Cinema 4D crashes.
No.
And so we'll go in here and do jellyfish.
It's a good name.
Right?
Thanks, buddy.
Okay. What do we got here? Let's go hair, spline, vertex. Maybe I want to have less spline vertices. We'll go uniform. And under my growth, nope, let's editing, regrow.
Better already, look at that.
Is that nice?
That's nice.
Okay, perfect. Next, let's go ahead and add in some wind. So we'll go particles, wind. Make sure that this wind is pointing down. I believe that's pointing down. Yes, it is. Okay. So why is our hair not showing up? Editor, show back facing, generate, because I'm doing this. There we go. Okay, let's go ahead and hit play. And then in our hair, I want to go to my forces and bring in the wind force. Set this to include. Do I need more speed, more turbulence? Frequency.
It's just spinning it along there.
Generate dynamics, rigid forces.
Include wind.
All right. Where's Chris when you need him?
Isn't that right? Isn't he so great?
I know. I wish I had my own Chris sometimes. Maybe let's really crank this up.
Oh! Gross! See, who said you weren't animating?
I
actually think, too, that the Z arrow is the wind going up. Are you trying to go wind up or wind down?
No, I'm going
to
go wind down. Good catch. Hey, this looks a lot better already.
You may want to like angle it a little bit because it's like not Woo. Catching quite. Oh, yeah. Oh, grody.
And then let's see. The turbulence scale, let's turn that way down so that these aren't all moving the same. And maybe change the frequency. So the frequency is going to be how fast like the noise that all of these get, it changes. Maybe let's really bump this up to 300%.
Yeah, because I think they're real wiggly.
Too fast, though. Maybe let's go 10 and 1500.
Oh, yeah.
And then we need probably like some good like some difference in the length of these here.
Yeah.
So I'm gonna change the hair. Let's go tools and brush. And in my brush, I can set this to scale. And I believe I have to pause this temporarily. Let's change the size of my brush so that I'm only getting a few of these at a time. We can change the strength. And I could also add in some variation through the hair material itself. But I really like the ability to go in here and really direct some of this stuff. And I guess at the same time, since we are doing a still, I could possibly just sculpt the hair instead of using the wind.
So it'll give you more control.
Yeah. So we can go in, where is it? Simulate. And mode, selection, edit, tools, brush again. I was already on it. Move. And so, just like before, too, in the last tutorial that I did with you, we can brush, and it's going to affect the tips of these, but not along the actual surface if I'm up there. So I need to go to simulate and choose my mode, and I can set this to points. And when I set it to points, I'll reduce the strength, and then I can start going in here and, like, kind of getting a softer, more effective distribution of turbulence that I'm really directing in there. And so now it lets you be a little bit more artsy about the whole thing. Let's get a little twist going in there, something that follows that other spline maybe. Let's go with a repel. That sounds like fun. Maybe repel some of these push them out. Maybe I want to move them down again after I pulled them out too much. There we go. It's not. Do you think there's too many of those hairs?
I think so. You know, maybe not.
It seems like it's pretty close to what they have, right?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Yeah. So there's
at least 8.
8, 10, 16, 32. I would guess at like a 32.
32, so I got 4 times 8. What would that be? 16, 32.
There you go.
Yeah. Okay. So we got 32. I like this, so we'll go back to our hair. Let's go to our generate type circle. And that's going to generate circular geometry for us along here. Now, look at this. It's actually creating all of our fill hairs for us. Mm. So we need to go back to our hairs. And then rather than using the count here, where's our growth? Cloning, interpolation, nope. Is it turn off the render hairs? We need to do that. We still got that one. I hate trying to figure out all of the options that you think you know.
What if you do what you did on the last one and just sweep all of these with
With an actual geometry? We could do that, but I think I figured it out here with the generate. So turning it off of as render and just setting a manual count here. So maybe I can do 32. That gives me 32 there. Then we can go to our hair thickness and we'll do maybe 2 centimeters.
Will we be able to add the transparent texture all together on this the way that we would, like, all with one piece?
Yeah, we should be able to. We'll find out soon, and if not, we can fix it. So we got that. Let's test out the material thing quickly here. So we got that. We got our transparency. Let's throw in some refraction. And then we need, what's going to be good to refract? I can't just refract black. Can I see through that?
It shows as transparent. Yeah, it looks like we're good.
Yeah, cool.
Cool.
Okay. So then we can bring all these guys back. We got some random stuff there. We got the hair going. And then we want to make some deformations on the actual top here. So we can group that together. Command G. Nope. Alt G. And this will be jelly fish. And also, before you ask me, I'll save incremental.
Thanks.
I know it was like coming up there, so we'll go ahead and we can do another displacer. And I want to do the fall off here again. So let's do a linear fall off. And we can kind of, let's go 0, negative 90, and 0. So perfect. Then our shading, what we want to do is use a gradient. So with the gradient, we'll bump up our height here. That looks like a lot of fun, but not what I want. So we'll try doing this on the 2DV, and this is way closer to what I want. Let's turn off the cycle, and then we'll bring another white piece in here. That's perfect. This needs to be brought down from 100 centimeters. Just need something smaller. And then in the gradient, I will double knots. And let's say we can even take this further. We can layer this up. We can duplicate the gradient. We can add some turbulence to this one. Maybe this one is on the U direction. Ooh, nope, we'll stick to the V direction. And every time we're using the displacer, we do have to worry about the geometry that's being created. So we'll go here, the jelly profile, let's set this to a uniform. Can kind of go there and then increase the number of subdivisions. And if we go back to our displacer, we should be able to see all of our nice detail.
That really messed up the displacer for some reason.
Yeah.
There just we reset go. It.
Refresh.
It's new geometry.
When in doubt.
Now, you may be already doing this, but can you add a gradient to the displacer to basically keep it from pinching at the top? Just like, so there's no deformation at the top and it gets worse as it goes down kind of a thing?
That's like a
fall off, basically.
That's what I was doing with the fall off here, because I wanted to have the control like this.
Mm.
So if I invert my fall off, I can just kind of localize that using the fall off.
That's it.
Rather than trying to do all of the work with the gradients. Now under the shading, I think what I want to do is my length X. Length Y.
We have to reset that displacer again. It seems like every time you do that, you have to kind of like reset it.
Yeah, it's not loving us for that. Doot, doot. Is this correct? Nope. 100. I hope the Wacom isn't picking up too much bumping here either. Length. Let's go 20. Yep. Which way am I going here? You know what? Maybe let's keep this at 100, and we'll just do it inside the layer here. So we can double knots again.
Oh, look at that.
I like that better.
Dig that.
Then we can bring this guy back in, maybe blend him, multiply that on top.
A little variation.
Yeah. And then anything else we can do with an actual material. So I think that should be a good starting point. The one thing that I'm missing is the bunch of stuff that we would have up in here, like the jellyfish brain.
Ooh.
Why
don't you put like a little what you think is a jellyfish brain, or like let's look at the reference, or maybe at some other photos?
I think a jellyfish brain might look like, do we have any awesome GSG models we can throw in here? Where's Whaley?
A Whaley brain?
Who doesn't want to have a Whaley brain? Maybe we'll just go for something simple. We'll dump a cube in here. Actually, what might be fun is going to...
Put the rubber ducky in there?
Oh, ducky would be good here,
too. A glowy rubber duck in the middle, like a bright yellow glowing rubber duck.
What I'm thinking, though, is maybe we just take our profile here. And we can edit that, and rather than use the cloth NURBS, we're going to Control Shift.
Add some natural roundness.
Yeah, and then this way, we can also bring in the centerpiece here.
Oh, gross! I love it.
And I don't really know what a jellyfish inside looks like, but I think this might look nice once you throw on some nice blurry textures and stuff like that. So we can do that. Boom, boom. Sure, once we add the displacer, super gross, still nice and clean up top, and then we have these. Okay, so we will do the safe incremental, and do you want to make it look pretty now? Or?
Yeah, let's start going into it. Can you freeze those hairs so that they're like locked in as a model so that we can move them around and do all those things?
Yeah, let's go ahead and see if we can just go hairs. Let's go with, I want to do more segments so they're a little smoother. 13.
Oh, and before, can you comb out a couple random strands that I think are like a more floaty on the edge?
Yeah, sure. So let's go to our simulate. We'll go back to our hair modes to tips. And maybe...
Brushy brush.
Yeah, simulate objects, hairs, edit selection. There we go, live selection. So one cool thing here is I can actually select the tips on a couple of these. Let's go with this one here. How many do we want here?
I was thinking some random like frilly strands out in the open, so just to catch some attention more.
Okay. So then we'll go back to simulate on our selection. I want to invert, and then I will selection lock selected.
Mm.
So now this way everything is locked in place except for these frilly ones that I want to start playing around with. So I'll go back to my tools and use the move tool. No, I want the brush tool. Brush, brush. And so we can start bringing these out. Maybe this one comes out this way. And again, the mode, maybe point mode would be a little bit better to work with here, just so I can get a little more control, bring up the strength.
Yeah, just a couple of those random dudes I think will help make it look
thing.
A little grosser.
Yeah.
You know?
So we can kind of do that. These guys out here. Yeah, I mean, that should be pretty close. Whoop.
Oh, we lost a couple of them.
Yeah.
Oh, no, they're there. I see.
I think they might be just really thin, too. Let's go with 60. And let's try doing a current state to object for the hair. Craziness. Okay. So that's not going to work that way. Hairs. Let's go with 32. And roots. Auto spline segment. Nope. Growth.
That should be close, at least for.
Yeah, let's
at least
try
that
again. We'll... Boom, like so. There we go. All right. And I think at that point, you can start making some shiny, blurry stuff.
We did it! Okay, I'm going to see if I can pull this off with my mouse. I may have to steal the Wacom, but I think we could do it.
Steal away.
Think so? Think yeah. We could do it? I don't want to mess everything up. Okay, so what I think, I'm just going to get it basically set up, but I'm going to leave this one up to your artistic eye, because I think you have a better eye for a lot of this stuff anyway. I was just going to give us some HDR. So... start with the HDR rig. That's going to allow us to give it some light to begin with. I'm just going to dump this into our scene here. I'm going to turn off our floor and turn off our background just so it's... maybe we'll leave the background on. Maybe we'll turn that back on. But instead of using a studio HDR, what I want to use is like a real HDR. So on my road trip, I took a bunch of HDRs of not underwater, but I think I have one of like a desert sunset that might give us some of the cool kind of colors that might be underwater. So I'm going to go to 3D Assets, HDRI, and there's one called like Side of the Road or something like that. I got to remember what it was called. Rest area, painful about parking. Oh, on the side of the road. I'm gonna use this one, mostly because of the colors. In fact, I'm gonna turn it on, scene by camera, And we just have these really, now the underground stuff's not the prettiest, but the sunset colors and all this stuff is really pretty nice. So I'm just going to see if it works, basically. I'm going to turn off the scene by camera. I'm going to add a new camera. And I'm going to kind of do that canting of the camera that might help this kind of be a little bit more gross. And I'm going to go in my move tool, kind of set up the scene a little bit, and kind of get, I kind of want to see more of it. So let's kind of set it up as something like this. And then maybe if I duplicate this, it all comes with it, right?
Yep.
So now I can set up another one that is like its buddy over here. And now we can kind of set up both, in other words, like for the scene.
Probably even put them in like a spline wrap, which would be cool.
Oh, yeah. So they can angle too?
Yeah.
Ooh, that's fun. So I could throw a spline wrap inside of this. And that it would go in here. And then you're saying I could draw a new spline. Mm-hmm. A new, let's go with a Bezier spline from one of the sides here. Maybe this one for the second one. And I could just, like, this one actually goes a little bit more sideways. That might be too aggressive. But let's find out. Object, spline, spline, boink. So now we have to make sure it's the Y. So it's going to be Y. It's not going to be that one. This is going to be negative Y. Is that correct?
Yeah. The one thing we might need to do is to unfix the bounding box. So on your spline wrap, go down to the bottom of the attribute manager.
Yeah.
Bounding box. And I believe it might be trying to fix it already. But what it does is it looks at all the geometry and then changes the size of the bounding box.
Gotcha. So it's not correcting it quite properly.
Yeah,
let's jump back at that once we'll have a render.
Yeah.
And then if we have time here at the end, I also want to space these out a little bit differently. So I'm just going to take this one and kind of pull it either up or back, or just kind of give it some space here, and maybe like look up into these things, give it a little bit more kind of depth to the scene. Some arms in front of this one. And you know what? I'm just going to rotate this one so they're not definitely like aiming at each other or hanging out together. So there's that. And I think we could pull this off with one texture all on the whole thing.
Oh, yeah.
Right? So there's one. And then we have one here. And I'm going to walk through some ideas for some textures. And I need you to absolutely stop me when I'm screwing up, because I think you might have a different way to approach it. In fact, I'm just going to do transparency. I'm going to do some refraction. And you're saying blurry reflections, right? You're saying go into transparency and turn up the roughness right away.
Totally.
Right. So now we have blurry. We need to do this into a team render. So let's go ahead and lock the ratio. Or, you know what? Let's actually do it more of a widescreen and do it more a little bit smaller, so that we can kind of get a little bit more epic here. I'm just going to do just a quick render. So this is transparency, specular's on. I want to turn off specular. That's probably not the best idea. But let's see what we get. So we're using team render here to try to speed things up a little bit. Might be too much brown in the scene. We may have to color correct a little bit of this, but already really, really cool, like tendrils. We got all these hairs coming out here. We got all this stuff. The general idea is looking real good. The specular is ticking me off. But
I think there's something going on with the hair, though. I think we have hairs growing on our hair.
The hairs are on our hair. So we go into our hairs and we delete these. Right? No hairs?
Yeah.
Well, that should do it. Do it on another one. Nope. That's the HDR rig. We need one more.
Null at the bottom.
Null. Thank you. Very well named, just like I always do.
And I'd probably like kill the texture tags that are on the hair objects too.
These here?
Yeah, since they have the...
This one?
They have the other like transparent material. Right?
Oh, I'm sorry. You already put some transparent materials on it.
Yeah, so just delete those tags off there, and then we should be good.
Just so we're all using the same one.
Yeah.
Okay. Gotcha. Now that the specular is off, I'm going to do that again, but I'm also going to add a little bit of the absorption color, and I'm just going to add like a little bit of that like reddish that's in some of the colors there, and set this a little bit lower, and make it a little bit more opaque as we see through it, but not a lot. This might be too much. I never know at the scale of these things.
Yeah.
So already we look like we're too much.
I don't think we checked the scale of the jellyfish at all ever.
Yeah, it might be a giant scale, but now we're getting some thickness.
Man, that is sweet.
That's pretty good looking. I'm going to redo it with a wider absorption color. And now you're seeing we're only getting the transparency. We're being able to see a little bit through our object. And might be too much. What's our scaling here?
Maybe just throw like a white background on there too.
Look at that. Look at that. That is true. Let's go ahead and cheat a little bit. Let's take a plane and go Z. Well, because the background itself might get replaced. Let's just cheat this a little bit and do this. So I want a blue gradient on this plane. Okay. This is how I like to cheat. Gradient. Boom. We're just going to pick some sea colors. What do we got? We got that one. And then we got a darker, like, darker sea, darker purple. Not quite purple. That's a sea. That's good. We're scaling it up. And we're putting it behind all this here just to get some better refraction. And this might actually, we might lose a little bit of our other refraction. So maybe we'll change this, or maybe we'll just angle this more so it's like down. So it's like actually picking up the down colors here. But what we have to do is turn on a compositing tag that just says seen by camera off. And then that way it'll get picked up in the refraction. It just won't get picked up in the camera behind it. So this might have too harsh of edges as well. There's a lot when we start faking stuff, starts to happen. Team Render's ramping up. We do have some colors coming through already. I could see some of that blue. I'm also going to go to our physical render and set up some really ugly physical render settings. What's your favorite ugly physical render setting?
Fixed with 0, 0, 0.
Yep. That's what I tend to go towards. Also, we go into our options
and then work up.
And we could turn our reflection depth down to something like 2 for now. It might not be enough for this object, but look at that, Patrick. I already want to add colors to this thing, don't you? I want to add like a like a pink in the middle of that thing.
Yeah.
Right? Then wouldn't that be nice? So now we have all this. We have all of our background. I even want to turn up our
absorption,
our studio rig brightness, just to get some of that going on. The absorption, I think you're right too. So we can shrink this a little bit, get a little bit more of that pink in the actual jelly there. Do another render. Oh, that pink is really coming through. It looks like it's only picking up that area. One thing we could do is just twist this and say it is U. Now let's try V. And now this might give it more of a gradient. It also might just pick up more. That's not bad. But what I am going to do
is kind of like the 80s sunset jellyfish.
It's a little aggressive here. I'm going to kind of cheat this. Try to get more blue in there and less pink. Oh, that's not bad. But it is taking a while to get to those other colors, isn't it? Everything's also being tinted a little bit pink because of our thing down here. We might be able to go a little bit more, don't you think?
I think so, yeah.
Let's go all the way to 10 and see what happens.
Yeah, I think before, just because it was like refracting nothing but the black background, it wasn't as obvious.
Yeah, already from here to here, we're already absorbing more, but we're adding more of that pink to it. So maybe that pink is like being overly doubled again, and we could push this back to blue and get more of an ocean color of that of our absorption instead of... Oh, there we go. That might be too much as well. But I do love that color. Little goes a long way with the absorption color because it kind of multiplies as it goes through the object, as far as I understand it. Like, look how dark that is, right?
Yeah. generally, like, I'll use the HSV selection for doing my colors.
In here?
And then I can set, like, a very tiny bit of the hue, and then mostly just control the brightness.
Gotcha. This is interesting. I'm going to turn on our background on our HDR and to see what our backdrop looks like. Don't know if it'll actually show. But what I do want to do is see if I can add a little bit of depth of field. Our objects are really big here, so it's going to take a lot of depth of field to kind of cheat this in. But I think we could do it. Let's set up our scene. Got some nice colors in there. And let's go to our camera. Let's pick our depth of field distance picker. Pick like right on the front of this first one here. I'm going to go to physical and start really small to make sure it works, 0.1. Then I'm going to go to physical, turn on our depth of field, and just do a render. And you can see now that we're using these very low render settings, it renders very quickly. Once the scene gets sent out to all the machines, basically renders instantly. Maybe we should stop using Team Render just for a second, render it local while we have a quick render here, and talk about things we could change. So look, like too bright, obviously the backdrop. So we could tone that back down. The colors of this backdrop. Do I want to stop rendering? I do want to stop rendering. Why would you keep rendering? Could be Team Render. So I'm just going to do a normal render. Look at how fast that goes. So still a little bit too bright in the background. The perfect background is going to be a little bit tough, but already we're starting to see we can cheat a little bit and just kind of angle up. But the model itself is holding up really well. That's very pretty. The absorption, I would say, is too much now. What do you think?
It's a tough one.
It's a lot of balance on this one.
Yeah. There's part of me that would almost want more.
More absorption? Just with brighter light?
Yeah. Because I really liked those saturated colors, but that's myself.
Yeah, me too. Dang it. But then it's almost the reflection depth that we could probably mess with. It might be the reflection depth doing it, but also we can, like we learned last week, we can go into the illumination. Nope. Where did we find out where we could do that? Was it transparency? Do you know how to set the outgoing?
In your reflectance channel.
Reflectance.
And then in your layer sampling.
There it is. Color. What should we pick? Like blue, basically, right?
Yeah.
Like everything's just going to be this blue on the way out. So now if we run out of reflection depths, it will like give us that. It's like too bright.
Yeah, I feel like just adding more depth to the reflection would probably be better.
Yeah, I think you're right.
We can afford it.
We can afford it. It's rendering fast, folks. Let's go back up to 4. And now we're just going to get a lot more refraction and all this stuff happening. Man, it was really looking a lot better before.
Is the exit color still white?
The exit color is now blue. You go to black?
Yeah, I'd go with colors for the refractive stuff.
Okay, so let's try that. There we go. And then I think the biggest thing I didn't like is just turn on my own background, which I'm just going to turn off, back off. And now we can crank our brightness back up in the background, which I think was helping our refraction and all this. Like now this looks better. Mm-hmm. Our depth of field is a little tough right now. But I think as we clean up that grain, it's going to be a lot nicer. So let's just try some other angles. Remember, we have a lot of depth of field on this thing. It's picking up a lot of brightness from our sky and all this stuff. So finding that right angle is going to be tough as well. Our depth of field is going to go a little nuts. Oh, that's a pretty one.
Yeah, I like that one.
Now, their angle on this was very clear. You can see how clear and all these brains and all the stuff that they have here. So we could also do that. We don't have enough of these things to do it, but we could drop like a few in a cloner, or now that they're all set up, like we could just really quickly just position a couple more and try to make them a little different, make them like this one's way close up, and just, you know, let's get like 4 of these and try to maybe rotate a couple so they're not perfect and see if that might be better. Now, our depth of field is going to be way off on this one. So let's go to physical depth of field just for now. Turn it off. But this kind of render, this kind of detail might be better.
Yeah. Well, the one thing with the depth of field, too, like if you know you always want to target one object, in your camera, you can set the depth of field target.
That's a good point. Let's set that up. So our first one right here is at the bottom. It's our bottom null. I think it's this one.
Yeah.
So we can go to this camera, and we can say, hey, wherever you are, I want the focus distance to be this target object, this focus object, and that's just going to be this null. Wherever that is, be in focus. Ding dong. And I go, okay. And now we could use depth of field, turn it back on. We'll get our backgrounds. We get all that stuff. So now if we added a background, we could add colors to it. We could add all this stuff. Now we're getting some cool stuff here. And we basically just need a colored background, right, to go with all this?
Totally.
What kind of gradient? Like, we could just shove this on there for now. That might not be the prettiest way, but now we have control over it. And we can like move the gradient around and do all this stuff. So let's make a duplicate. Let's do that. Let's look at the original as well and just see some colors. We got really dark down here up to bright. Let's try to replicate that. Let's go to our luminance. I think our dark blue might be a good idea. Really deep dark blue. All the way up to, I would say, almost pure white blue.
Pretty much white, yeah.
And from here, we can actually set the angle and also the color of this. Really push the blue even into a black, right? Even into like a desaturated, like that might be a little aggressive. Turbulence, right? We could add not too much. It gets a little cloudy. Turn the octaves down and our angles somewhat like that. This might be a little bit too on the nose. Without enough detail, we're going to get a little bit more of that like sea color there. These are too bright for me. What do you think?
Yeah, that's totally coming from that pink there too.
Let's just tone this whole thing down. Oh yeah. Still that pink, dude. I'm turning it off for now. Actually, that might not be a good idea because then it'll be just black. Just turn it off. For now?
Yeah, that might be good. Just like pick up the background. That's actually closer to the reference.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think it was a wrong way to go.
I'd kick up the absorption more then.
Yep, gotcha. A more absorption, transparency, reflectance. Transparency. I'm sorry. This is. Let's just go 4. Let's go like.
And what's the color? Did it reset to white?
It did. I thought we had a little bit of blue in there.
Dark.
There it is.
Ooh. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Too dark. Is that a distance thing or a color thing, you think?
I'm going to go with distance.
There we go.
Yeah, because the original image has that nice, like, little bit of pink in there.
I'm going to forward a little bit more as we're getting close, a little bit more rendered. Samples, just so we could see some more of the clear stuff there. We got those really weird, nasty, like, turns and curls on all these things. And then, of course, with depth of field, what we're missing is ultimately a bunch of these. Okay, so we can turn off our camera. We can look at everything. We got our camera coming from here, basically looking up. Okay, so now we can take... What, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 of these, 4 of these, and duplicate it and just start breaking stuff. So I'm going to push a bunch toward the camera and just, we could position them in the camera basically. That might be random enough already. I'm going to take one more, duplicate it, and move this further back, which is way over here. And then one little last hack I think we need for the ground, or for the water effect, is this. You take a disc, you take a cloner, and you basically make a grid array that fills your entire scene. So this may be really big, actually. Right?
Yeah, yeah.
It's, I mean, these are the scale on this thing.
Somebody probably should have modeled this thing to scale. Like, who made this?
Who made this?
Who made this?
Let's go with 6,000, 7,000. Yeah, that's better. 7,000, 7,000, 7,000. Let's go with 100, 10, and 10. And maybe that's too much. 60, I don't know. Maybe we'll do 50. We'll do instances, and we'll do 50 of those and 20 of these. And we got disks everywhere. Now what do? We go random effector. We go to our position. Definitely random positions. Let's go 500, 500, 500. Let's go scale. Definitely random scale. Uniform scale. Let's go 0.8. We'll hit the wrong button there. And we all want all of these to actually aim toward the camera. So we could use the, what do they call that? The target effector, right? We can go target effector. Boom. And we could take our camera.
That looks really cool in the viewport, too.
That looks pretty fun. Take our camera and say, this is our target object. So now, hopefully, we got to use the right up vector. Might be Z, actually. So that looks not right.
You might want to go into the cloner, and you can set the rotation in the cloner. So if you go to transform...
Yep.
Just set like the pitch to 90.
And just rotate them all around.
Yeah. And they're super tiny, so.
Okay, let's see what we got. What's our scale on these things?
We're gonna find out soon.
Yeah, so I'm also gonna save incremental. I'm also going to reduce the rotation segments pretty low. 5. I still think they're all aiming in a different direction. I'm going to go back out to our camera. I'm going to turn this off. And there's all of our objects, and they're all jumping a different direction. So
they're all on edge.
They're all on edge, so we can't see them. So target, object target, camera, use pitch. Okay, now they're all going down. And we're just going to see if one of these is the right one. X. Sometimes, like, none of them are the right one. Have you ever seen that? Like,
Yeah, that's why I tried out the rotation thing in the cloner. So when you go to the transform, maybe it's not the P. Just try, like, 90 on H.
Now we're getting real tricky. Okay, guys, the only reason for this thing, this cloud, is for depth of field dust, right? There are some plugins out there that do this. I'm actually just going to remove the target effector altogether. And I'm going to scale these down, obviously, so they're more like little disks, little floating dots. And all we're trying to do is get a little bit of depth of field stuff so that when we do this drastic depth of field, we get floaties in the water. And floaties in the water always sell an underwater look. Now, I don't know if this is going to be quite right or the white right colors or anything like that. Usually adding more of a brighter color to it might help a little bit more. But now we're going to start to get underwater dust and grime, and it's going to break up that background. And we can also scale things differently, but we're basically, frankly, not even having enough depth of field, but we are getting close. It might even be too many of them, right?
Yeah, I'd say too many, and then like more scale variation would probably look nice.
Yep, they're all like too small or too big. One way we could do this is just drop more in and make this second one like bigger, and then use the random effector to scale it. So we still have a lot of scale going on. Let's do another team render here, and we might want to turn up our depth of field. So let's go do that. Physical point. So our scene scale is just so big. We might have to cheat our depth of field a little bit. And these are definitely slowing our render down, but kind of dig the way it looks. There it goes. It's almost a little bubbles, a little floaties, a little grime. Like, it's adding a lot of detail to that. Even still, we don't have enough depth of field.
Probably the 0.01 was good there.
0.01 was a little bit closer, wasn't it?
I mean, these are like, what, 5 meter tall jellyfish?
They are big, right?
Yeah.
These things?
Probably bigger. Maybe like 10, 15.
0.01. I would say this saturation down here is a little heavy. I would say maybe bring it up and darken it a little bit. Make it more like that.
You'd probably go with less white, too.
Yeah.
So I also find with the gradients, when I'm doing the blending on them,
yeah.
If you twirl down the little arrow there,
yeah.
Rather than the smooth knot, I find the cubic bias always provides like a bit of a smoother blending.
Mm.
Although that's giving us sharper. A pretty sharp edge there, yeah.
It's interesting. Cubic bias, cubic knots. Let's try that one. Getting that gradient, getting an actual photo in there would probably help quite a bit.
Yeah.
But we do have some depth of field issues here we got to solve. Hopefully 0.01 will be enough, which is it's a lens Kubrick would have really liked back in the day, 0.01 f-stop. But we could cheat things a little bit because we're trying to get a specific look here. And look at that. Ooh, ooh. Now they're like out of focus. All the ones in front of us and behind us are just like so blurry, right?
Yeah.
But now we have some nice dust going on. I want really the dust to be more out of focus. So I'm just going to crank this up. Make it bigger, right? I'm just going to see if I can get a couple that float too close to camera. 0.01 might be a little aggressive.
Yeah.
But what's nice is once we get close, just doubling it literally doubles the stuff that's in focus. So now twice as much, this will be twice as much in focus. That's not a bad start, though. A little more clarity, obviously. We need a lot more samples. What else do you see, Patrick?
I mean, for myself, the gradient still would need to be fixed. I guess I'm not too sure why it is blending that way, though. Like, it gets darker going between two light colors. What's the document space in this? So, like, is it sRGB or linear or...?
It should be sRGB.
Workflow? Yeah.
So it's a little weird. Is it because of the angle or anything, or the turbulence, or like, I don't know.
Maybe the turbulence.
Maybe we just use diagonal instead. And.
But it's still weird that it goes black. Like.
It's very, very dark. Yeah, that transition is aggressive, right?
Yeah. Maybe try something other than the... cubic knots.
Here we go. Linear knots. Smooth knot. I could just cheat that knot a little bit. And then we actually don't have reflections turned on. So what's your take on with transparent objects? You gotta do this, right? To have reflections, you gotta turn the brightness down a little bit for reflections to show up, or is that not true anymore?
It probably is better to have a little bit there. Like, for something to reflect, you do have to have a diffuse surface on there.
So I'm just gonna add like a general slimy like Fresnel on this and tone it down. Maybe a little less Fresnel, just to try to get some of that like reflection on the outside. Is there any last changes on our absorption color, different colors, or how would you take this? Because I'm basically at the point where I'm doing the little tweaks, and I think your eye is, I think, more artistic than mine.
Well, I think with, like, the original, like, we would be pushing more into the pink color. I think. Maybe double check the image again.
Yeah.
I did like the pink just because it like nicely offsets off the blue background
off the
there.
Blue.
Which I think is great.
All right, let's do a render here. Got a little pink transparency. Got some depth of field. And I think this is one of those where the settings are going to have to get cranked up quite a bit, you think?
Oh, yeah, totally. If you have, like, heavy depth of field, you need to make sure that you're at least, like, sampling the scene initially really heavily.
Now, that's what I've found over some setting tests, is fixed actually works better with depth of field because it's more aggressive with the sampling, basically.
Yeah, it samples every pixel with the exact same amount. Whereas adaptive, it'll kind of be like, if you see like the little spots that are here, it might look around and be like, oh, maybe I don't have to sample this one, when
gotcha.
Really it does.
I think we're getting close with this. There's obviously some depth of field issues here. I kind of want to focus more on like a closer one. I feel like this one's like just hidden.
Too far?
Yeah, like yeah. If I just change this angle a bit and take this one and try to find it, and use that as our focus point. I think there it is. 4. So null 4, camera. We can go to our object, null 4, swip.
Boom.
Boom. And anything else before we try one more render here? We got that. We got our background. I think
go into the transparent material.
Yep.
And in your transparency texture, add a Fresnel shader.
Here?
Yep.
Yep.
And then jump into your Fresnel and invert the Fresnel.
Oh, it's this one. Invert knots.
So what'll happen there is I'd also go to the color and maybe reduce the color so that it's not white. Like maybe make the color that pink or like a dark, dark, dark.
Mm-hmm.
And then back in the transparency, I always love using the physical option in Fresnel. So you can do that, just check the physical checkbox, and then invert again.
Oh, invert the Fresnel.
Yeah, and so this way when you get your like your refractions and your transparent object, it's going to be nice and dark around the edges.
Ooh, okay.
Can slow things down a little bit, though.
Hey, we're already close to a minute of frame here, and by the time we crank our samples up, move this up, it's going to be
50.
It's going to be an hour-long render. Transparency with physical render. While I have you here, and you use the physical render a lot, any workarounds? I mean, the physical render is, to my opinion, nice, but it takes a long time. What are some settings that we can look at?
My biggest workaround, if you ever look at my portfolio work that I pick up, my biggest workaround is a secret. But if you look at my renders, there's only one render that I have that has transparency. Maybe two. And that's my secret to keeping things speedy, is to not use transparency at all.
That's the tip. Don't use transparency. So Jellyfish, you were excited. You're excited about the Jellyfish because you never get to use transparency. This is looking really good. This seems a little dark to me, but I think this is something we could do in Photoshop or in the levels here. Just a little bit.
Our exposure
of like
is
gamma.
At 0.3 too.
Well, I didn't notice that. Our exposure, I think, would help. A little bit of glow up from the top here. And so there you go. That also might be why our background's a little bit bright.
Yeah, that was probably the issue there.
But yeah, already right there, we could add some vignetting, we could do all this stuff. But you can see we're going to have to crank the samples up way high to get some nice depth of field. Now, these dust particles are not not responding the way I hoped they would. I was hoping for some more floaties, some more stuff in the scene here. Maybe they're just not big enough. I'm just not sure what to do with these other than, you know, experiment a little bit more.
And yeah, that might be nice. Like, I think the fact that there's not enough samples, too, like, some of them just might be
getting missed.
Getting missed, yeah. Or we're seeing through them.
But let's go back and see as some of these frames come in. Much cleaner. You can see we still have a long way to go as far as our grain for our depth of field.
But your floaties are looking a lot better now.
I wish there was a depth of field, like, just crank up the depth of field samples, but I don't think that's how depth of field works, right? It's so real that you can't you can't just say, put more data toward the depth of field. You physically just have to turn up the samples in the entire scene, which make it pretty
heavy to render.
Pretty heavy to render.
But you cannot beat the results that you get from that.
Yeah, physical render, more and more
gorgeous.
Is very pretty. Like this, you know, didn't take very long. A little bit of tweaking. And you can just kind of do what the world says to do. You know, make it transparent. How much does it absorb? Throw some reflections in there. And it takes care of the rest, you know. I really like it for that. Yeah, our dust is looking better. Our little floaties will look really nice. I think maybe for the final render, and Patrick, we can get on this here right away for the full size render. I think a little bit of art direction on where these things exist in the composition.
Yeah.
I think that's something you're really good at doing is
and we can
setting up the comp.
The spline wrap for those too so that there's a bit more variation in them.
The spline wrap for the... Oh, yep. Yeah. So some of them are moving around. Okay. Yeah. So when you see the final, it'll be maybe a couple of them will be angled a little bit differently. The composition itself, I think, needs a little bit of work. I like the way that this one's hanging out right here, but I would rather like crop it here than have this ding dong sticking his head out. But that was fun. Thanks for coming by, man.
Yeah, again, thank you for having me out.
Hey, thanks again for watching, everybody. Don't forget we have all the seasons of Ask GSG available on our training page. So if you missed past episodes or can't make it to future episodes, check out our training site where you can get access to all these recordings as we make them. So with that, I wanted to thank you once again for watching this show, and I hope to see you in another video really soon. Bye, everybody. Jellyfish. Should I make a song for every tutorial? Jellyfish, dum bum bum bum. Jellyfish, 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 baby back ribs. I don't think that'll go well together.